Dobri den, thank you for coming. Some of you have been to my previous workshops and some have not. And you'll find some themes coming back if you've been here before. Today's workshop has a very strange name, the Content Monster. And the reason for this strange name is to address a concern, I would say the most common concern that I hear about the techniques that I advocated in the first two workshops, the general techniques of active learning. And people say, I think those techniques could be effective, at least some of them, but I can't use them because I have too much content to cover. And I don't come here today to make fun of or dismiss that concern because I think it comes from a very good place. It comes from this place where we have this ethic of responsibility to teach our students everything that we can, for them to learn as much as possible. So I think it comes from a good place. So what I'll try to convince you of today is that we can honor that responsibility to our students more deeply if we come to our teaching from a place of how best can the students learn than from thinking about what we're going to say. And I hope I can convince you of that today. This is the content monster itself, and I think it's always sitting on our shoulder saying, stop asking them questions, you have to talk, because we have to give them all of this information in such a short period of time. My first method of suggesting that there might be another way is a short example. And around you, there should be a piece of paper somewhere near you, or if you find a blank space around you, which is a short reading about hot peppers. And if you haven't had a chance already, I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to read it, and then you're going to take a quiz on this information. So imagine that you've read it before coming to class today. That's the way to think about the reading. So please take a moment to read for yourself.
Now, we'll give you a short quiz, and as I said, it's a closed book reading. The idea is that you read that before you came to class, and you come to class. And this, although you know I like to have people work in teams, but this is to begin an individual quiz. So, here, as soon as you receive it, choose the one best answer. There's only one best answer. Once you're satisfied with your individual answers, find some colleagues near you, especially someone, well, I haven't gotten over to the side of the room yet, but that will have this little scratch-off form. It looks like a lottery ticket, or at least like a lottery ticket in my country. Not sure what they look like here. Can we pass one up there? Let's see. So what you'll need to do is choose what you think is the best answer, and someone will need a coin. A 2-crown coin works quite well. 1 crown. Or a key if you don't have a coin. And scratch off what you think is the correct answer. And if you're right, you'll see a star somewhere under there. If you don't, try again, because you get half credit for getting it right the second time. So keep trying. How many teams got all the questions right on the scratch-off? So several, right? All right. I don't want to embarrass anyone, but I bet fewer individuals got all the points right on the scratch-off. There's usually a great enhancement on the team effect, although I know at least some individuals did do that. So this is sometimes called the readiness quiz, right? Are you ready to work with this material? My students take them all the time. They love the scratch-off forms, especially. They find that tremendously fun. Fun is not the point, but I think they also prepare much better for the quiz, knowing that the full fledge of their ignorance may be displayed to their friends and colleagues in their team. So I think they usually prepare quite well. Notice that the quiz, if you look back, which you may do now at the pre-work, that the objectives, learning objectives, which you might have not even looked at, and if so, you're just like students, the learning objectives are exactly what's tested on the quiz. And you have to do it that way. You can't ask your students random things from the reading. From your perspective, they won't be random, but from the student's perspective, they will be. They have to be things that you said, okay, what do I want you to get out of this reading? This, 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 and this. This is what you should be able to do, right? Written that way. And then you ask them to do that on the quiz. The quiz, relatively low-level content. Do you remember what it said in the reading? Having spent the first 10 minutes of class then with the individual and team quiz, and my quizzes are usually longer, this is just a little example, then we move into these conceptual questions that get into the material more deeply. I'm just going to use one example for this, so please read and then decide, and you may look back at the reading now if you like, decide what you think the best answer is, and I'll ask you to vote on it or to discuss it in a moment. All right, now today I don't have my voting cards because another teacher is using them, so I ask you to vote using a simpler, even simpler method, which is to hold up the number of fingers that you, so if you think B is the right answer, don't vote yet, you'll hold up two fingers and so on. So just one vote per team, all right, so make sure you've agreed with your team as to what your favorite choice is. All right, so choose a team leader who will be the voter for this moment. Ready? And I'll count backwards as usual. 3, 2, 1, vote. All right, we got, assuming the thumb counts, we have C's over here, A's, B's, no Pilsner? Come on. So, oh, there's a Pilsner, okay, good. And mostly C's and D's over here. Okay. Would you guys be willing to justify your choice?
Okay, because in the text it's written that you need sugar and alcohol, which is mostly combined in Bailey's.
You have both your sugar and your alcohol. And what do the sugar and alcohol do, or the sugar or the alcohol?
I think it was actually alcohol and fat, which solute the capsaicin.
Thank you. Yep. Do you want me to bring the mic or do you want to yell? Either way is okay.
Because it's not written in the text, there's just written it's soluble in alcohol and fat, but it doesn't mean it lowers the hotness.
So that's an interesting question. Why does it matter whether it's soluble in alcohol and fat? So it says in the reading that the capsaicin is soluble in alcohol and fat. Why would that make you feel better? Both. Go to both.
Well, because if it dissolves the capsaicin, it will take it away from your tongue or from your mouth. So.
Is that what you were going to say? It removes it from the receptor, the taste bud, which is what's causing the sensation, yeah, of pain. That's all correct. And thank you for that question. That's really important. Because I think sometimes students write down soluble and fat, and then they don't understand why that that's a relevant point. So that is actually the case. There's actually even an additional reason sometimes individual students happen to know, which has to do with a protein in milk. Anyone know the last reason? Casein, which is a milk protein, specifically binds to capsaicin. That wasn't in the reading, but sometimes students like to bring in their outside knowledge. And I saw a couple people nodding, so I think maybe you were just shy to confess that you knew that as well. So typically then I don't teach about hot peppers, this is just an example, but I would proceed to a question. I'm not gonna ask you this, it's just an example. But you've opened a restaurant, you read in the reading about the two methods. Given your goals for your restaurant, which one is the best method to use? The students discuss and debate that, getting more deep into the concepts of the reading. So this is just a really short example of how you can motivate students to do reading using these little scratch-off cards and quizzes. You can take a short amount of time for that and freeze up class time to then dig deeper into the material. Now, this was very short, but I hope some of you would say, I learned a tiny bit about peppers today, right? I learned a little, maybe something practical even for for use when eating something that's too spicy. But notice that I haven't told you a thing. I told you nothing. Well, that little fact about casein, but basically nothing about peppers. So it's possible for students to learn quite a lot from a combination of reading and discussion, both class discussion and individual discussion. And this can work for your content as well, and I hope I can convince you of that in the remaining time. One thing we can say to the content monster to shrink him in our heads is that speaking, communicating information through lecturing can be effective if you're speaking to other experts, but most of the time we're speaking expert to non-expert, and you get a pretty low yield from that. It's not a very efficient way of communicating information, and it's also one that can be done outside of class. We can provide basic information through lectures online or through readings, and encourage our students to actually take in that information through a variety of methods, but one would be these little scratch-off quizzes, which they love so much they don't even notice it's a test. And another thing is that, as we discussed previously, and some of you were there two workshops ago, is that you can't, if you remember the cow, and if not, explain it to your colleagues in a dull moment today, you can't transfer understanding by communicating information. That as we speak, our students often believe that they understand what we're saying, and perhaps they do understand the words, but that we can't communicate our true understanding. And often when students give us back the information on a test or orally, they're giving us back the words of it. But when we probe, we can see they don't have any true understanding of that. Even if you say, well, look, I don't want my students to know any deep things about what will happen if they open a restaurant. I just want them to memorize the structure of capsaicin or something like that. Even if you just want them to have this low-level knowledge information, and all of us have something we want our students to memorize, typically, even then, students will learn that information better by testing themselves on it and practicing it in your class than they will by you talking. And that's been shown by so many studies, and I showed you guys this meta-analysis, sort of famous meta-analysis from 2014, where, right, these are all the classes where having students do things in class increased their learning, and these are all the ones where lecturing increased their learning. So you can see there's a tremendous difference, and the effect size was so large that the authors said if this were a study of two drugs, that the study would be stopped, and the active learning drug would be given to all the students. So then I think people say, okay, I know that students can get information outside of class. I believe you that that's possible, especially if I enforce it through some method. But then what do we do in class? What actually, how do I structure what happens in class besides just making up questions to ask my students and talk about it? How can I go about it in a clear way? And the way we used to do it, right, was we'd say, okay, I have to cover these organ systems or these philosophers or these historical events. The semester's 12 weeks long, so I'll divide it into 12 parts and off we go. So we used to say, okay, we'll just choose the most important content and we'll hope that this leads to students really thinking about it and being able to solve problems about it, even though there's not much justification for that hope, right? But what if we said, why don't we start with what we want the students to do, the outcomes, the goals at the end, and then choose whatever pedagogy, whether it's asking conceptual questions or lecturing or team problem solving of quantitative problems or anything else, choosing the pedagogies that, based on what we know from the teaching literature and from cognitive science, are most likely to achieve those. So this kind of thinking, and this is really how we do anything else in our life, right? If we say, I want to be able to run a marathon, well, what do? You say, well, okay, if I'm going to run a marathon, I signed up for the Karlova Very Marathon, and this is when it is, and so, okay, I need to be able to do this by then, I better buy some shoes, maybe I'll get a running partner to make sure I really run, right? You work backwards from your goal of being able to finish that marathon at the particular date that you have in mind. So it's really just the same kind of thinking of saying, here's where I'm trying to get, what's the most logical and the most literature-supported way to get there. So that's led to this overall idea of what's sometimes called the flipped classroom, where what used to happen in class, the getting of information, moves to out of class, and the using information, which we'd often ask our students to do by writing or solving problems for us outside of class, becomes something that at least partially is done in class. These are my students working in class on various problems, and I put myself in the picture because sometimes I'll talk about this and people will say, well, why do I need to be there now? What's the point of me if the students are just doing all the learning by themselves? And so the reason I added myself is the role of the instructor really becomes more important now, because what were you doing before? You were describing a bunch of information and maybe being inspiring, and that's awesome, but describing a bunch of things which really the students could have gotten in some other way, at least relatively easily. Whereas now you're orchestrating the series of activities and events that the students would never have been able to plan on and do on their own without you. So in my opinion, you become more important in this flipped classroom sort of situation. If I were you, I'd say, well, what's the evidence that specifically this sort of thing is effective, and I'll show you that some of that in a moment. But a way to think about it sort of conceptually is, in the traditional classroom, students don't really know what's going to happen when they come to class. They know you're going to talk about the Crimean War or something, kidneys, but they don't know how hard that is or what the details of that are going to be. And as the teacher, you say, okay, I think what's going to help them understand kidneys or the Crimean War is this, and that's you do your absolute best to help them understand that. But if they have a flipped classroom situation, students come to class thinking, I don't understand why something being soluble in something would cause it to make you feel better. I don't understand whether I need to know the structure of this molecule and what that has to do with its effects, or whatever it is. They come with their specific questions. And if you gather a little information about what the students are confused about before class, when there are various ways of doing that, you can anticipate where the students need the most help, even if you don't. I collect these as students are doing them, and I see, well, everybody got number 3 wrong. Why is that confusing? And we immediately discuss it until it makes sense. So we're hitting what needs to be hit, the areas of potential confusion. During class, what normally happens? You're in a big hurry to try to get through everything, and they're just trying to keep up and follow along. If we have a flipped classroom, students are practicing whatever it is that you want them to know how to do, and you sometimes give little mini lectures, you give feedback to the students immediately, but you're not guessing and you're not trying to get through some set of material, because you know that that's not necessary to do that in that particular moment. I brought just a few pieces of evidence because I don't want to spend the whole time on this today, but there's a lot of evidence that if you switch to a sort of flipped classroom where students are doing work during class, they're able to perform a lot better on equivalent exams in the class. So this is an example from a physiology course because that's my particular field. You can see the difference both on these individual exams and at the end is, you know, something on the order of a whole mark or grade, a whole 10 set of 10 percentage points, which is a tremendous difference in learning, obviously, for those students. This is a much lower level introductory class, and they called this learn before lecture. They had students do these learning modules online in this particular case, and then take quizzes about them. And then when you look at the final exam, they performed almost infinitely better here, not infinitely, but far better on the genetics questions, and then significantly better on all the other fields where they examined differences between the two groups. Sometimes students learn more in the flipped classroom, but they don't think they are. And a really interesting example of this was this algebra class, a math class, where if you look at the final exam, and this is a really well-controlled study where they had the same instructor and the same material and so on, and the control students averaged a 70% on the final exam, and the flipped averaged, you know, not quite a whole grade higher, but much higher, 77 on the final exam. But if you ask them, you know, did the instructor did a good job, the instructor effectively facilitated my learning, you see that the students actually thought that the instructor did a better job in the traditional classroom than in the flipped classroom. So it doesn't feel to us like teaching, and it doesn't feel to them like learning. And I think it's hard to initially get over that, even if the students are performing very well. I found a tremendous difference if I explained to students why I'm teaching this way, what the evidence is, and it's not that I'm too lazy to write a lecture to give to them, and that I love to give lectures, as I think not all of us, but many of us do enjoy telling the story of whatever it is that we're discussing that day. So I think this is an interesting thing, and really in line with a lot of other studies that show that people don't really know how best to study and learn. If you were here for the first lecture, you saw this expecting to teach study, where students who expected to teach content did better on the final, better on an exam than students who expected to take an exam, which makes you wonder what the people who expected to take the exam were doing and why they weren't doing the same thing that the other students were. So there's a lot of misconceptions that are out there. I think for all of us, we have misconceptions and the students do as well. But the data for you know, what happens to performance is quite strong in these particular classrooms. And I think we know this from our own lives, you know, whatever it is that we've tried to learn, you know, learning to ride a motorcycle, learning to speak French, whatever it is, that you learn it from trying and failing and making mistakes and improving, and whoever's doing the work is doing the learning. If you're preparing a lecture, you do a lot of work, and the students usually do nothing. A few of them do the reading, and most of them do nothing. So whoever's doing that work is going to be learning. So I think it's critical, and you know, we've talked about this before, this will only work if you tell students exactly what you want them to be able to do. Because if you're not going to tell them, if you're not going to stand there in class and define ventilation and inspiration and expiration, then it's not fair to ask them that in an exam or other assessment format unless you've told them this is information that you're responsible for. If you have any difficulty finding, you know, sources of information about it, I'll help you. This is what I suggest. Here's the book. Whatever it is. But you have to tell them. because they can't magically figure out what it is that you want them to know about kidneys or the Crimean War unless you tell them. So you tell them, and you can tell them really hard things, I find. You can tell them lots of really hard things as long as they know what it is. But if they know what it is, they can do a tremendous amount. Then how do they get that information? So if you're not going to define ventilation, inspiration, expiration, all these things in this example of teaching students about breathing, how are they going to get that information? Well, my students mostly get it from reading. In my particular field, the textbooks happen to be excellent, so it works out. For your field, it may be from reading, it may be from watching something, it may be from some other source of information that you suggest to them or that you give them options to choose from among. Sometimes I'll make my students little videos. If you haven't done this before, it's a lot easier than it used to be. Even if you really don't like technology, it's tremendously simple now to do this. I could set this up in 15 seconds on my computer and record something. So sometimes for things that are really difficult. So in this video, I'm explaining to my students why there are male and female animals, which sounds easy, but is really complicated and confusing. The students tend to mix it up with why there's sexual versus asexual reproduction, which is a completely different question. They get very confused about it in general. So I put a little picture of myself talking, because there's some data that show that if you can see someone talking, you'll watch the video for longer. And then I show them my slides on it. And this whole thing is just less than 9. I didn't do anything. Really. Oh, good. You can make these little videos. It's very easy. And the great thing about this, too, is, you know, every year, normally, I used to go in and basically give the same lecture about this. Now I've given it once, and as long as it's good, the students can watch it again, again and again. And even within an individual class, you'll find that for difficult or confusing concepts, students will watch this many times. They'll watch it, they'll go to class, they'll watch it again, they'll talk about it with their team or their friends, and then they'll watch it again, and then they'll watch it again the night before the exam, each time increasing the sophistication, I believe, of their understanding. Sometimes you don't really need to make these videos because, again, things have changed. There used to be a lot of awful things on the internet, and now there's a lot of awful things on the internet, but also a lot of great things on the internet. So for example, when I talk about kidneys, and I do a basic overview of kidney function, I don't make a video because whoever this person is does an awesome job. They lecture about it just as well as I would, and they draw about 1,000 times better than I can draw. So there's no reason for me to give that particular piece of information to my students through my own mouth. I mean, sometimes you think, like, right now, right, what is it? It's April, beginning of April. So at least in my country, like right now, there's like literally at this moment, like 1,000 people explaining how the kidney works. Are you the very best one of those 1,000 people? And if you're not, let somebody else explain it, right? Or again, if you don't like the way they explain it, you can explain it yourself, but in a way that students can review again and again and still frees up class time to do more complicated things. Okay, so students are getting information some way out of class, videos you made, videos someone else made, reading, a movie you wanted them to watch, whatever it is that's relevant for your discipline. And then how do you plan class? Well, you look at all your goals. And for me, I look at some of these and say, well, some of these are really obvious, like list the structures air passes through from outside your nose to your pulmonary capillaries. Well, there's 1,000 places they can find that information. It's very simple. There's no reason for me to list it on the board so they can write it down in their notes. It's just a waste of time to do that. But a question like this is very complicated. The students memorize what tidal volume is. See? Complicated. They memorize what tidal volume is and these reserve volumes, but it's the kind of thing where they memorize the definition and they don't really know what it means. They don't deeply know what it means. So when they come to class, I ask them, when you blow out all the candles in your birthday cake, what capacities are you using to do that? And this actually is not just a purely fact question. It's sort of interesting question. And you can see the teams fighting about this because they say, well, you go, and then some of them say, no, because you go, and so is another thing. And so do you include that or not in the question? So they fight about it, and as they're fighting, and honestly, it doesn't matter. You could either include or not, right? But as they're fighting, they're learning what these things really are, and they're learning them in their physical body, right? And they're learning them in their mind. What are these different capacities? This is still a relatively straightforward question. I move on to things that are somewhat more difficult. This is something that's not, can't be parlayed into a birthday cake situation. If your air pipe or some other place that air passes through is half as wide, how much less air passes through it? Of course, students tend to say half, and that's not how physics works. And they can solve this equation with math, but they can't usually solve sort of the word problem version of it by themselves. So they work on this, and eventually I can get a majority of teams to choose E, which is the correct answer, that even a half smaller air pipe only passes 1/16 the flow, because physics, as we say, in class. And then we move on to a question like this, brings us back into real life. If you're hyperventilating, why do people say to breathe into a paper bag? It's relatively straightforward physiologically, but not something that students can easily figure out on their own. So instead of me saying, okay, class, there's air and it moves into your trachea and through your larynx and through your pharynx, and they write it down, instead we're talking about applying, we're really using this information in ways that I think gives them a deeper understanding of what all these terms mean, because I made them learn, and on this, right, on their quiz, they will have shown that they know the order that air passes through to their lungs, and they know the structure of the lungs and these other basic things. They know the definitions of these words so that we can have a question like this. If you don't prepare for your students for class, if they don't have to prepare for class, and you give them a question like this, well, they can't answer it because they don't know what any of those words mean, right? But if you've stimulated them to prepare, they can do it. So what I ask you to do at this moment, this is my last question for you today. You can do it too, don't worry, is to think or write silently for a moment on this question. Like right now, what are you thinking? Like, I don't think so. What is it that's in that? What sort of objection or reason might you have for not using this kind of pedagogy? So just think for a moment about that. And now whenever you feel ready, just turn to your neighbors and share your concerns. Maybe you could alleviate them, maybe you'll reinforce them, whatever happens. All right, I'm sorry to interrupt you, and I hope you have a chance to continue these conversations with your colleagues, some of whom you just met. But is anyone willing to share a concern that someone in their group had or that sort of keeps coming up in their mind, something that they're thinking about when they think about a challenge of teaching in this way? I'm sure I haven't converted all of you. At least not completely. Coming.
Thank you. I'm teaching mathematics, and I have another teacher who is doing the theory, and he doing the exams. And I just only practicing with the students, the examples and solve equations and some like that. And if I choose this type of teaching, I'm afraid that it isn't compatible with the teacher who does the theory and the exams.
So it's the same class that you both teach in? Yeah, so I think team teaching, which is common in many different places, is a central problem, because you can't say, I'm going to teach this way. I don't care what you think. It's not something that can be effective. So clearly, you need to make your colleague come to these talks. But beyond that, I think you need to talk to your colleague and potentially to the department chair, if your colleague isn't the department chair, about that and say, here's why I think I want to try this. What if maybe you could suggest trying it in a incomplete or limited way? Something that your colleague might feel more comfortable with. Explain that you're not crazy and that there's evidence, and be willing to compromise and hear your colleague's concerns about that as well. But good luck. I think that is a major challenge. Other things that you're thinking about? Oh, I'm sorry.
For me, the biggest problem would be that it's not really normal to do it like this, and that I would need to be like weird and just yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not easy because of this. Yeah.
I'd be happy to come talk to your department if you think that would help at all. So this is true in lots of different places. I'm very fortunate that it's become less true in the U.S. and especially my university. There's hope. So in my department now, you're kind of weird if you don't do something like this. People have different things that they do, but something. And people get defensive if they're just lecturing. So I hope that your department makes a journey in this direction as well. But in the beginning, yeah, we need heroes. So I'm not being very helpful, am I? I agree, this is a significant challenge. And again, I think if you can come with listening, with compromise, and with evidence to your colleagues that usually different people are susceptible to at least one of those three things when you talk about it with them. And especially if you can do it once and show evidence from your own class that students learn more. However, that doesn't always happen. I do have a colleague who teaches mathematics who produced tremendous results with switching over to a technique called team-based learning, and he's still the only person in his 40-person department who uses anything like that to teach, and they all think he's weird, but fortunately he doesn't care. He wants the students to learn a lot, which of course his colleagues do too. But,
yeah. I'm a bit afraid if I gave the students some pre-work, they wouldn't do that because it's not traditional,
yeah.
It seems to me.
Yeah. So. So there's sort of two issues here. One is they're not used to doing it ever, right? And the other is they have to be convinced that it matters whether they do or not, right? So the first one is rather easily fixed in that the first time you do, the quiz or whatever method you're using, you can do it online before class if you don't want to take class time for it. Whatever method you're using, the students will do terribly on it because they didn't really believe you that they had to do it, right? And then you'll see gradually that they improve their performance on it. But you have to show them that you mean it, and that you mean it in a way where you want them to learn more, not that you mean it like you want to punish them by failing this quiz, but that you mean it from the angle of helping them do better. And I think we often don't explain to our students why we do what we do pedagogically, and they assume we're just lazily making stuff up. And so if we tell them this is the reason for this, this is the evidence, a tremendous number of them will actually believe you. And of course you are speaking from a place of authority as their instructor as well, and they believe you. So your other concern is that the related part though is that they're not used to this from the rest of their life. And that too is something that I have seen, once you get more than one person doing it, students begin to expect it, and now when I teach my team-based learning classes and I say, oh, we're doing this team-based learning, I don't even need to explain it because the students already know what it is. But in the beginning, I think a solution to that is, again, really explain to your students why you're doing it this way. and that you're doing it out of respect for them to spend class time doing valuable things and not things that they could have done on their own by watching a video. And I think if you show them that it's out of respect for them and their learning and not as some kind of weird punishment that you dreamed up, you'll get more buy-in, as we say, from the students to do that. Other concerns? Thoughts? Okay, be better.
Thanks. Hi, dobrý den. I think that it's really hard to switch to this method or to this way of teaching during the semester. Like if you, for like 2 months, use the classical way of teaching, then just switch to completely different one, it's almost impossible. Like in my first year of teaching, I was really afraid to use methods like this. And then when I became like encouraged, they didn't accept it. But when you start with it, like you come and like behave like this is normal, this is the way how you will do it or we will do it, they just accept it also automatically. You just have to be brave enough to like not to be nervous and just express it like something normal.
Well said, I agree completely. In English we have a phrase for the thing that you said at the end where you say fake it till you make it, you know, where you sort of act like you understand how everything's going to work in the class until it does. So I think, yes, it's hard to go in the middle of the semester. I would make two caveats to that. One is, what about just having like a minute paper at the end of class? So you lecture, whatever your traditional method is, and then at the end of class say, okay, what did you learn best today? What are you confused about? Or ask one conceptual question in the middle of class and one at the end. Nothing too scary. Sort of a partial introduction to some of these ideas of, I'm going to try to find out what you guys are learning. I'm not going to, you know, change the whole system in midstream. But in that way, you get to test out a couple of different techniques and maybe see what you want to do when you do something more serious. The other response I would have, although again, I mostly completely agree with you, is we can always come up with reasons, right? Well, I'm in the middle of the semester. Oh, I had a baby, although that's a really good reason. A lot of time, at least in the US, people say, I'm not gonna switch until I get tenure because I don't want my teaching evaluations to go down, and so not until I have this sort of secure job am I going to do anything that might make any student go talk to my department chair about how mean I am. So it depends on the culture of your institution, I think, to some degree there, but you can always think of a reason why this is not the semester to do it. So I would say commit to it being some semester if it's something that you want to do in there. Okay, so I think I'm out of time. I'm happy to answer more questions, but I just wanted to summarize. And this is a slide I used at the beginning, I think, of my talk two talks ago, but I hope that you maybe believe it more now, that it is true that if we reduce our, not teaching, but I would say talking, students can potentially learn more. I know some people need to leave, but I'm happy to stay and answer questions from anyone who doesn't need to immediately depart. Thank you. And just raise your hand if you do have any questions.
Maybe in the case which you described, like the first few lessons when the students were not like really expecting you to test them and they didn't learn, what do you do? Like what happens during the lesson if all you have prepared is some very like activities presuming they know something?
You have to keep going. And the reason is this. Students, you said students prepare, they don't. So you just tell them, okay, the list of structures that air passes through. What's the lesson to the students? Yeah, I didn't need to prepare. She's just gonna tell me what the list of air passes through. She's gonna tell me what inspiratory reserve volume is. So you have to show them that you mean it. And I think sometimes people are like, well, I'm going to gradually make it more like that as the semester goes on. But it's really the same as parenting or anything else. Like, begin as you mean to go on, because that's what you're training your students to believe that you're going to do. I think you can acknowledge it. You can say, hey, you guys aren't really used to this yet. I understand. Maybe can I have a volunteer to define inspiratory reserve volume or something like that, but not where you just back up into whatever you would have done if you weren't trying this new way, because you're just training students to believe that you don't mean it that way. Could you pass this?
Hello. Well, first of all, I would like to thank you for this lecture. It's very illuminating. My biggest concern is that once I give the initiative to the students, they can take lead of the discussion, and the discussion may go either astray, or I may not follow the structure of my lecture and not cover what needs to be covered. Or at the end of the lecture, there might be so many different views that the conclusion will be complete mess. And I think the conclusion should be like more clear, so that the student leaves with an impression that we had a conclusion. And I would be afraid that I might not wrap the lecture at the end so that the students get this impression. Thank you.
Terrific question. And I think, you know, very broadly we can say, well, when I give students control of discussion, I don't know where it's going to go and whether it's really going to go in the direction that I need it to go. So I would say I often have so many multiple answers, but two things to that. And one is, it's often good to let students drag the discussion somewhere, because you didn't realize the depth of the misunderstanding that was there. And I have a 9-minute video on YouTube if you want of that happening in my classroom. And it's really interesting, and you can sort of see me be like, you thought that? As we go through, but it's critical. And in fact, you can see in the class, in that little video, that more than one person has this completely non-biological idea of what's happening. And so I think it's absolutely critical to teach this way, in my view, because otherwise, you know, what happens is that you just paper over their misconceptions with your facts or ideas, and they write them down on the exam, and the paper falls off, and then they're back with their original idea. And so forcing them to sort of confront it with these problems, I think, and when things come up, to say, wow, you guys think that, okay, tell me about that, you know, so that it can be explored. But your other concern is that, yeah, but how are they going to get to the end and know sort of the basic themes of what needs to happen? So one thing you can do, and I know a lot of people that I know do, is in addition to just general, okay, and now we're going to move on to this sort of guides as you go, you're not just letting them talk about anything for an hour and a half. At the end, they give a summarizing mini lecture, 5 to 10 minutes, saying, and you include what people said. You say, okay, and remember when, you know, Petter said this, and Team 6 was talking about this, and you guys had trouble with this problem, and that's an example of this, and so on. And so you're sort of tying it together. And you don't want to do that so much that the students, again, are sort of waiting for you to tell them the answer at the end. You want them still to be using their minds throughout, right? But it's enough to sort of make everyone, you and them, feel better, especially in the transition to a new way of teaching about that. And I'll often do that if I feel like my students are completely confused. I'm like, okay, we're going to the whiteboard, and I'll get out and draw, and we get the idea. And then I give them a question to see if it made sense. But then they're listening, right? If you said, here's da-da-da-da-da-da, they're not listening. But if they get into this place where they're so confused about what's right, and then you say, da-da-da-da-da, then they're like, oh, because they're waiting, they're ready. It's the teachable moment is sometimes what it's called. They're actually listening to you now because they care, because they got to that point of confusion. And we're ready for that, for your expertise about it. Yep.
If I'm teaching only a part of the semester, Is it reasonable to use this flipped format if the other teachers use the classical format?
I would say only if your methods of assessment are completely non-overlapping. That is, if you teach half the semester and give an exam, and then your colleague teaches half the semester and gives an exam, absolutely. Otherwise, it's the same thing as essentially your question, in that whoever's pedagogy you need to coordinate with, you absolutely need to talk to that person. And not come and say, I'm going to teach this way, but here's some things I've been learning, here's some things I'd like to try, I don't want to interfere with your, you know, what if we did this, or what if I tried this, and see if you can reach something that's a compromise. But that's a major problem. Yeah. In American medical schools, almost everything is taught, team taught, and so a lot of the pedagogy changes have come from above, where administrators make them change. Because medical schools can't be reaccredited now if lecture is their main method of instruction, because the evidence is so strong. But I don't think it's a good way. I think if someone tells you to change, you do so in such a resentful way, and like letter of the law kind of way, but not really changing, that it's better to do it bottom up, out of your convictions. I've heard that's the way that some Czech industries treat EU regulations, is by technically following the law, but I don't know. I was told that this was part of the character to have your own view of how things work without necessarily following the spirit in all these ways. Well, thanks everybody, and if you have any individual questions, just come afterwards. I have one more of these dealies. And we'll talk about how to design classes, sort of thinking about it in this new way, and that's in a few weeks.